Two Lost, a Morgan Stark Mystery, Book 4. Written by Rylie Dark, narrated by Sarah Kempton. Prologue. Diane Siegel drained the last few drops of champagne from the flute she was holding, savouring the tiny bubbles that disappeared in seconds on her tongue. With the exaggerated care of a person who had drained a few too many flutes that evening, she set the flute down on the granite-topped counter. She rarely overindulged, but this time she had. The room swam around her a bit. That was okay. She deserved it. She'd earned it. She looked out over the railing at her sunken living room. The kitchen and dining room were on her level. Home offices were the next level up, and their bedroom was at the tippity-top of the house, making her feel like she was going to sleep in a treehouse every night. Down in the living room, her colleagues were all there celebrating. Everyone from her lab techs to the CEO of Medtheon Inc. was there. Honestly, they were celebrating her as much as her accomplishments. There had been round after round of toasts earlier, extolling her vision and intellectual curiosity and the patience with which she ran her lab. She smiled. She deserved that too. She'd worked so hard for this moment. For 15 years, starting with the research she'd done for her doctoral dissertation and continuing until the present day, she'd been working on a vaccine to prevent spondylococcal varicella. Today, the FDA had announced its approval of the vaccine that she'd developed. It would take a little while for manufacturing to ramp up and for distribution lines to be established, but within a year, Diane's work might be able to eradicate spondylococcal varicella completely. It could go the way of smallpox within a decade, relegated to a sample or two kept in a secure lab. It wasn't the most common disease in the world. There were only around 800,000 cases per year. Of those cases, however, 1 in 5 would have complications that could plague them for the rest of their lives. 1 in 10 would die. Those were not good odds. From down in the living room, her husband caught her eye and lifted his glass of champagne to her, a smile spreading across his handsome face and pride glowing from his hazel eyes. Damn, he still looked good to her. She blew him a kiss, swaying a little as she did. This was his celebration too. A lot of female scientists didn't have the kind of home support system that she'd had. Paul had truly been a partner to her, each of them helping each other as their careers progressed, him in law, her in medical research. They were far from done too. They had years ahead of themselves. How many more diseases would she be able to eradicate? How many more people's rights would Paul be able to protect in his work? They weren't crusaders. You'd never find them up on soapboxes or screaming over someone else as a talking head on a news program. But they'd both dedicated themselves to the greater good. They were making the world a better place. Together, they'd built an amazing life for themselves, too. They truly had it all. Jobs they loved that felt important, a comfortable place to live, and, of course, each other. Their home was beautiful. A modern split level on close to 2 acres of property in Virginia. It hadn't been cheap to have it designed by an architect and then custom built, but it had been money well spent. They had the money after all. Both of them had been very well compensated for their work. Truth be told, she'd have done the work anyway. Well, she was more than happy to cash her paychecks, drive a nice car and live in an elegant home, but the real impetus behind her work was a bright and happy young woman who would never have the chance to live up to her potential. Diane had been 19, a sophomore at Brown, when her roommate, Sarah, had gone to bed with a headache and a rash and had never woken up. Diane had found her unresponsive the next morning and had called 911, but it had been too late. Sarah was dead less than 24 hours later. The sound of Sarah's mother's wailing echoing down the hospital corridors was something Diane would never forget. Ever. Diane pinched the bridge of her nose, willing back the tears that stung behind her eyelids as she remembered the anguish of a mother who'd lost a child. She wasn't usually this sentimental. That champagne had really gone to her head. She needed some air. She turned her back on the group of people clapping each other on the back, hugging and clinking glasses, and made her way to the sliding glass doors that led from the kitchen to the deck out back. It was dark out, and with the bright lights inside, she saw only her own reflection approaching the glass. Stumbling, she caught herself on the counter to steady herself. Wow, she'd really had too much.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.